Everyone, and welcome back. Sorry I've been very absent lately. I haven't really posted many videos out. I'm fully aware that I haven't done as many as I'd certainly like to. A lot has changed in the last couple of months, such as back in September, what with doing a change of career from sort of property and then going into motorsport. I started a level 3 kind of like college course in motorsport vehicle technology. So I started that in September, and we are now a couple of months in, almost sort of finished my first year, and I think that's kind of taken up a lot of my spare time in the evenings. I've also moved out of London, moved to Essex, so a lot of driving as well, sort of taking about an hour and 45 to kind of get anywhere at the moment, sort of down to Kent for studies as well as into work still, because I'm still in London working. And then of course any kind of motorsport work that goes on as well, because obviously that season has now started again. And yeah, so the washing machine's going in the background is probably not ideal if that's what you can hear. As well as that, we've also got a new addition, which is here. That is Twinkle. She is a St. Bernard. She's now 6 months old, I believe. Twinks, hey, you gonna say hello? No? No, not really. She's just been for a walk, so she's a bit tired now. She was a bit nutty earlier, but now she's just totally asleep. But she's like a big teddy bear. Bless her. So yeah, a lot has changed in the last couple of months, and just thought I'd sort of stop in and sort of kind of give you an update as to what's going on. So YouTube is something that I definitely want to do more of, but it's just a case of at the moment, it's a Sunday, and they're kind of in my only times that I'm off at the moment, so it's just kind of trying to work everything out and find the time to do this kind of stuff. But yeah, today we're going to do a video on the daily. I feel like there's a lot of things that you can tell by the choice of what someone has as a daily vehicle. Obviously the whole point is that it's, you know, a car that you're going to be using a lot, you're going to be putting a lot of mileage on, you know, you're trying to sort of save the other car, the secondary weekend toy. So, you know, daily sort of relatively kind of simple choice of vehicles. Yeah, so let's go and check out the daily, and unfortunately she doesn't fit in it, so I'm not sure how long this daily is gonna kind of be around for, much longer, because I need to be able to fit the big teddy bear in. Yeah, she's just not interested at all at the moment. So yeah, let's go check out the daily. My daily driver is a Volvo C30 T5, which probably you wouldn't really put a Volvo and a C30 as kind of like a hot hatch, but do you know what? It's not too bad. I haven't had it for two years now. I've had this car, and it certainly wasn't something that I was looking for originally when I was looking for a new daily driver, but this kind of cropped up. So we'll talk a bit more about that, but let's get away from this busy road to start with, and let's put some glasses on too, because it'd be good to actually be able to see where I'm going. Involved with the car when driving, but at the time of looking for a car, Volvo C30 T5s, they just don't come up. They're really hard to come by.
and at the time of looking there were no manuals about, so that's kind of why I ended up with the automatic version. And to be totally honest with you, I'm kind of glad that I got an automatic in the end, because, you know, I spend 3 hours a day driving my car, getting to and from work or sort of college and all around the UK for work with the racing weekends and stuff and mechanics. So I'm glad that I ended up with an automatic, because sitting in London traffic is actually quite a dream. It's almost like I end up hunting for traffic in the end, because you're not really that bothered by having to constantly, you know, clutch control and gear changes and, you know, making a gap to keep rolling through. So the actual gearbox itself is pretty good. It's actually quite a smooth power delivery. The only thing that I've found with it is when you are cruising at about sort of 30-40 miles per hour, kind of around the suburbs, it does tend to hold the gear for quite a while before it changes. Now the only reason why that's an issue is because I thought, you know, a year and a half ago, it'd be a brilliant idea to put a straight through exhaust pipe on this car. Which I thought would be great. And I horribly regret that now, because when it holds that gear in sort of the slower speeds, like 30-40 miles per hour, that droning from the pack is so bad. But, you know, that's my own fault. Nothing a resonator can sort out. So I will eventually get around to sorting that back out again. But it sounds pretty cool otherwise. And it definitely complements the 5-cylinder. So getting on to the engine side of things, obviously this is the 5-cylinder, it's the 2.5-litre turbo, and yeah, you gotta have, if there's a bigger option out there, you gotta go for it. So the T5 was absolutely on the list in that sense. You know, obviously it shares as well the Mark II Focus ST chassis and also the engine, so they both share the same thing. When I was looking again for daily driving cars, you know, I wanted something that was reliable. It's not very fuel economic. That wasn't really my main concern, because what it lacks in fuel economy, I think on average around sort of London at the time, I was getting about 25 to 27 miles to the gallon. Obviously now my driving's different and I'm spending a lot of time on the motorway. I'm actually getting about 30 miles to the gallon now, but I can't get it over. I can't physically get it any more than 30 mpg. So maybe that's just my style of driving. And I like to get to places on time, or with a lot of time actually to get to places. But again, what it lacks in mpg, do you know what it makes up in reliability? So, you know, it's a brilliant engine, it's a Volvo. You'd have to do something horribly wrong for this, you know, to break. You know, it's a Volvo, it's a tank, they don't break, you know, they just don't break. If you're going to break it, it's probably because you haven't put oil in it after you did the oil change, and that's when you're going to break it, because of, you know, you or me or whoever. So yeah, it's a great engine in these, and you know, you definitely love the sound of that inline five. It's kind of one of those things, unfortunately my exhaust does drown out a bit, but beforehand it was a really nice sounding, obviously, engine as well. As I haven't actually modified the engine in any way. It's something that I would like to do, is actually to get a Polestar upgrade on it, so get the Polestar map done to it. Maybe one or two little modifications, because like with anything, we always say, you know, nope, it's just a daily, I'm not going to modify it, I'm going to keep it totally stock, and before you know it, we've got new 18-inch black alloys that have been resprayed, and then I've gone and had the whole of the car colour-coded, because originally the car was actually black textured paint, arches, all the arches, all the side skirt was textured paint like this, all the front bumper was different as well, the rear bumper was totally black textured. So whilst I was in for some repairs, I actually had the whole of the car colour coded as well. Unfortunately I couldn't find a rear bumper, a rear R design bumper, which has got a slight diffuser cutout, it just looks a bit smarter, and the red reflectors are a bit smaller, so it's a bit more of a sportier looking side of things, but I couldn't find one, so unfortunately I just got that repainted in the end. Yeah, so it just looks a bit more tidier and a bit sportier. So when it comes to the interior of the car, the first thing that you'll notice is the center console with the floating waterfall effect on it, which is very streamlined, it's very thin, is a very elegant piece to the inside of the vehicle, and I quite like that. The only thing that I would kind of probably have to go against is that the top buttons are all okay. The buttons are relatively, you know, easy to use as such, but I do find myself always having to look and check the lower parts, those lower buttons, because I can't actually tell which ones I'm pressing half the time, which is basically just to the direction of the fans, and especially the heated screen in the morning, because I have no idea which one it is. I always have to look at it, and the aircon, to put the aircon on is a bit of a strange. It doesn't put you on aircon, you have to press an auto climate and then the aircon button. It's a bit confusing, but once you kind of figure it out, it's pretty easy enough. It's a four-seater, of course. I've only actually ever sat in the back of this car maybe twice before. It's a really comfortable place to sit, actually. I like that the rear of the seats are individual, and then you've got an armrest in the middle that folds down. So it's a nice place to sit in the back. I will give it its due. The actual driving position of the car as well, it sits quite low. You'll find that the door cards are actually quite high on this car. But everything's relatively easily accessible. It's got a pretty standard, you know, analog dials in front of you. The steering wheel itself is all okay. It's quite big, but at least it's got all the multifunctional steering wheel applications that you'd want on it for your cruise control, and obviously all your radio functions here on the right hand side. The indicators, it's a one flick, three blink indicator. So everything's kind of relatively easy to use. You've got obviously your lock button on the driver's side, electric windows for the front. You've also got electric adjustable wing mirrors as well, which is a pretty handy feature when you're trying to park your car and reverse back. This car's also got rear parking sensors as well, which is really handy. I haven't had a car with rear parking sensors before, but it's really handy. It's a very lazy way of parking, I have to say. I don't think I ever really physically look back anymore. I just check my wing mirror now, or my rear view mirror, which probably isn't the best way to go. But I haven't reversed into anything yet, so it seems like the best way to do it. It's not flashy, but it's got the basic necessities that you would want as a daily driver. So, you know, I really can't complain. The exterior of the car is something that I think you have to have a real Marmite kind of take on it, because when Volvo originally designed the C30, they wanted something that was a little bit more adventurous, a little bit more unique, and they certainly got that with the rear of the car, as well as keeping sort of within touches of having, you know, that hatchback look about it, kind of keeping it sporty as well. And it's one thing that you wouldn't think of. You wouldn't necessarily put Volvo and hot hatch in the same sentence. It certainly wasn't something that came to my mind the first time around when I saw one of these, but you can actually kind of really get the feel for it. And that rear tailgate is very, very unique. It's fully glass. They actually got the idea of that from the P1800 ES Sport Estate that also has a full rear glass tailgate. And I always wondered about that, because when you look at the car and the way they've designed this, obviously you've got the wider edging contrast from the back that dips down to the front of the car, and then of course you've got quite a sporty, aggressive looking front end with smoked headlights, and obviously a slight black trim as well to the top of it. So the front end looks really sporty, but I could just never understand what that back end was about. So of course when I found out that it was originally used in the P1800, that made a lot more sense. I didn't really like the back end of the car, but again, it's kind of something that I've just kind of grown to like. And to be honest, I spend most of my time in the car, so I'm never really looking at the back of it anyway. When it comes to the actual handling of the car, I'm actually gonna drop this down. So we're in semi-auto. The handling's not too bad. The braking's pretty great as well. It could definitely do with some stiffer suspension, if I'm going to be totally honest with you, but it certainly pulls well, I'll tell you what. Especially for an automatic, it's not too bad. Yeah, ideally I would like some stiffer suspension. The rear end I find is a little bit, rolls a little bit much. You can kind of get the front end, the nose, to tuck in a bit. Kind of testing the integrity of my brakes right now. But it's not too bad. To be honest, I just like listening to the sound of that exhaust in the back, so I think it sounds phenomenal. It's a bit Asbo, and it's a bit over the top, and it does drone a lot, and it is a bit annoying in that sense. I mean, you just want to cruise along for the motorway, but when you kind of get down a country lane like this and you drop it down a gear, it is pretty fun. I tell you what, it does pull really well. I'm not really one to give it my daily spirited drive because, well, I just kind of poodle about in it most of the time. But I tell you what, actually, for a country lane, this is the great thing about moving out of London. You get some really nice roads to drive around. So the handling's genuinely not that bad. I don't think I'd go take it on a track day tomorrow, but for out the factory on the original OEM suspension, it's okay. It handles well. In true driving fashion, we're going to put it in semi-auto because we want to make it a little bit more exciting. Give it a rolling start. And it will hold the gear pretty well, to be fair. The only thing with these country lanes is that a pheasant likes to run out last minute, or a deer, one or the other. So guys, I'm gonna round up my C30 T5 daily video. I hope you guys have enjoyed it. As I've always said, this is a really underrated little hot hatch. It's not something that I ever would have come across myself, or I just kind of stumbled across it when I was looking for a new car and sort of did a bit of research on it. Like I said, there were a couple of compromises that I had to make. You know, I wouldn't have chosen an automatic, but I'm kind of glad I did get an automatic because it's just easy to drive every day. I didn't really like the back end of the car. You know, I know it's very unique, but I wasn't very keen on it. But again, you know, it's something that I've kind of grown to quite like. You know, and it's just been so reliable. And you know, for what I paid for this car, which honestly wasn't a very much, you know, wasn't a lot at all. And I've been able to sort of add a few modifications to it and, you know, get it more aesthetically pleasing for my own, you know, preferences. You can make it, you know, what you want. And it's been a great car over the last 2.5 years. And as with anything, obviously with a change of, you know, sort of getting a bit older and, you know, I've now got a great big dog at home. Yeah, this is probably going to have to go at some point because she doesn't fit in it anymore. And I know I've got the Land Rover Defender to drive around in, but I can't drive that to and from work every day. And it already takes me 1.5 hours to get into work. And I think with the Defender, it'll probably take me about 2.5 hours to get into work at 60 miles per hour, going down the hill with the wind behind you. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. As always, I'd love to hear your thoughts on the C30 T5 because you don't really see these about, and I can't say I've ever really seen these about, especially T5s. So let me know what you think. Drop any comments in the description below, and we will catch you guys super, super soon. Take care. See ya. Look who's here to say hello. Oh, someone's excited now and woken up. Okay. Let's get out of here.